When we connect two switches together, we need to think about things like, what happens if that link fails? And do we have enough bandwidth between these two switches? So to increase redundancy and to add extra bandwidth, we're going to use a technology called Etherchannels. We've recently been talking about spanning tree. What would spanning tree do in a case like the one you see here? It would effectively block one link to prevent the loop, right? But we still need to consider having two links here for redundancy. That is, if one link fails, the other would be available to take over. The second link is basically a backup in case the first link fails. This is good, but it could be better. Let's say these are both 1 gig links. What happens if we have high levels of traffic? If there's more than 1 gig of traffic, this one link wouldn't be able to handle it, and some traffic would be dropped. Does the second link help out? Nope, it's blocked. It can't do anything. So we could upgrade the link, but that may be expensive. So let's look at an alternative. Etherchannel is a technology that takes two or more physical links and bundles them into a single logical link. So back in that case where we had two links between a switch, we could configure them as an Etherchannel, and they would pretend or act like they're a single link with up to 2 GB of bandwidth. And because it appears as a single link, spanning tree wouldn't block anything, so both physical links can be active at once. If one physical link fails, the Etherchannel still works as normal, with diminished bandwidth, of course. This means that spanning tree doesn't need to recalculate or send TCNs or do anything like that. As long as at least one physical link is up, the logical link will stay up. You can usually have up to 8 physical interfaces in an Etherchannel. Some switches allow you to go as high as 16. Before moving on, there's a couple of things I'd like to briefly mention. Firstly, Etherchannel is a Cisco term. They also call it a port channel or a channel group, as these are the commands that we use in configuration. Other vendors will use terms like LAG, which is Link Aggregation Group, or perhaps AE, which is short for Aggregated Ethernet. Despite the different names, these are all standards based, so that means that you can configure an Etherchannel on a Cisco switch and connect it to a LAG on another vendor switch, and it will all continue to work just fine. And of course, we always have some quiz questions through these videos, so here are a few to get you started. Etherchannels can be configured either manually or dynamically. We'll start by looking at manually for now. We first need to add a physical interface into the Etherchannel. We're going to start with gig 0/1. Under the interface, we're going to enter the command channel group 5 mode on. Notice number 5? This represents the logical interface that we're creating. It can be any reasonable number. We'll soon add a second interface to this channel group. But first, do you notice that we say mode on? The mode is whether this is manual or dynamic. Using the on keyword means that we're manually configuring this channel group. This means the switch will assume that there is a valid Etherchannel or LAG at the other end of the link. You'll also notice that as soon as we leave the interface configuration, a new interface called port channel 5 has been created and is up. Let's jump into another interface and we'll add that into the same channel group. If we used a different number here, it would be part of an entirely different Etherchannel, so it's important to get the number right. So far, we've added physical interfaces gig 00 and gig 01 to a logical interface called port channel 5. We can configure this port channel interface just as we would for any other interface. For example, we could configure it as a trunk port. We could just as easily make it an access port, or add an IP address to make it a layer 3 interface. We'll just add a description while we're here. To check if it's working, we can use the command show Etherchannel summary. This shows all the port channels configured on this switch, as well as the physical member interfaces. There's also a few flags next to our interfaces, which we can decode using the handy table above. In our case, you can see that we have a layer 2 port channel. Now here's another quiz to get you thinking. You might need to try this in a lab or by doing your own research. As always though, it'll be time well spent. We can improve on Etherchannels by making them dynamic. What makes them dynamic? They exchange messages between the two devices to agree on whether an Etherchannel should exist here or not. Let's consider why we might want this. Imagine two switches are connected with an Etherchannel. But now someone comes along and moves one of the links to a different device. Now this isn't valid. Etherchannels are intended to be between two devices only. If this were configured as a manual Etherchannel, our switch would continue forwarding traffic over the link, assuming that the other end is also correctly configured. This would result in traffic being dropped. However, if it's dynamic, the switches continually share messages with each other. If these are disrupted in some way, the switch will know there's a problem and will shut down the miscabled link. So, dynamic is good. In fact, I recommend it wherever it's supported. Cisco support two types of dynamic Etherchannel. What I mean is, there are two different protocols that we can use to exchange messages over the Etherchannel. These are called LACP and PaGP. PaGP is an old Cisco-only protocol. It's rarely used anymore, so we're not going to look at it in any detail at all. Instead, we're going to focus on LACP. LACP was originally part of the 802.3AD standard. It was then moved into the 802.3AX standard. This makes it vendor neutral, so we can connect other vendors' switches to our Cisco switches if we want to. LACP is used to check that both sides are suitable to form an Etherchannel. This means there are certain parameters that need to match on the physical interfaces for the Etherchannel to form. These include the speed and duplex, access mode or trunk mode, the VLANs allowed on the interface, the native VLAN if it's a trunk port, and spanning tree settings. Let me show you another reason why we want to use LACP on our Etherchannels. Sometimes we have a passive device between our switches, perhaps a media converter that converts fiber links to copper links. If the media converter fails, the switch links may appear to stay up. The switches are blissfully unaware that there's a problem. They will continue sending traffic over the failed link, or rather trying to, which results in traffic loss. However, remember that LACP regularly sends messages between our switches. If there's a fault in the media converters or the cables between them, then the LACP messages won't get through. When these messages go missing, the switches will know that there's a problem and can take an action such as alerting you or shutting down the faulty link, allowing regular traffic to flow over the good link. LACP itself can be either in active or passive mode. An interface in active mode will actively start sending LACP messages when the interface comes online. An interface in passive mode will only send LACP messages if another device starts sending them first. So at least one of the two switches needs to be in active mode for an Etherchannel to form dynamically. Please note, a manual Etherchannel does not send or receive LACP messages at all. Okay, let's see how that's configured. We configure the type when we add physical interfaces into the port channel. So let's go back and change interface gig 00 and gig 01. We previously configured this with mode on, which is a manual Etherchannel. We'll now remove that configuration. Notice that this takes the logical interface down. For the Etherchannel to be up, at least one of the member interfaces must also be up. It currently has no member interfaces, so it's down. Now to configure LACP. There's a few modes we can select from. We're going to configure this with mode active. Of course, that brings the Etherchannel back up. Now that's done, we can use show Etherchannel summary to confirm our results. I recommend that you use LACP active mode wherever possible. However, you will find occasions when you want to configure a lag or an Etherchannel to a device that doesn't support LACP. In this case, a manual Etherchannel is your only option. I've thrown a couple of tricky questions in this time. You may find question 4 to be particularly tricky. Let's talk for a while on how switches distribute load across the physical links in an Etherchannel. For our example, we're going to assume that there are 4 physical links. The way this works is a bit complicated, and it can depend on the model of switch you're using too. But it essentially comes down to a process called hashing. Hashing is used for a lot of things in the IT world. We'll see it again when we talk about security later in the series. A hashing algorithm takes any input and generates a fixed value as an output. The output that it generates is a bit like a signature, and that signature represents the original data. You can think of it a bit like you're in a library. Books are organized according to category and are given a number. This number represents the book. Using this number, you can find the book. Let's take a very oversimplified example. We'll pick a number, let's say 9. This is our original data. Now for our hashing algorithm. Our algorithm will be to take the original number and divide it by 4. The result of this is 2 with 1 left over. We could say that the 1 left over is our hash value. We could take any number we wanted, apply our algorithm, and get a hash value as a result. So, although real hashing algorithms are far more complicated than what I've just explained, basically there's an input value, and there's an algorithm, and there's a hash value that we have as a result. So, what's this got to do with Etherchannels? Think about a frame that needs to be forwarded across the Etherchannel. The switch will look at the frame's details. This might include things like source and destination MAC address, IP addresses, and port numbers. It will take these values and run them through a hashing algorithm and generate a hash value. To keep it simple for our example, let's imagine that a hash value will always be 1, 2, 3, or 4. The switch will assign certain hash values to particular physical links in the Etherchannel. So a frame with a hash value of 1 may be sent on the physical link 1. A frame with hash value of 2 may be sent on link 2, and so on. The real hash values may be a bit more complicated, but I'm hoping you get the general idea. At this point though, I'd like to clear something up. The hashing algorithm is not LACP. It has nothing to do with LACP. LACP does not decide how traffic is spread across these links. The hashing algorithm process is independent and will run regardless of whether we're using LACP, PaGP, or manual Etherchannels. Going back a step, I said that we might use values like source and destination MAC, IPs, ports, and so on. The values we use are configurable, and the options you have available vary a little depending on your switch model. To see what we're currently using, we can run show Etherchannel load balance. You can see here that we're currently using source and destination IPs as the input to our hashing algorithm. We're not considering MAC addresses or port numbers. Can we change it? Absolutely. It's done with the port channel load balance command. Here you can see all the methods supported on this switch. Bigger switches will have more options. Let's change it to use source and destination MAC addresses. So, is there any reason we would want to change the load balancing method? To be honest, in a lot of cases, no. We can leave it happily at the default setting. However, there are occasions where we will want to. Let's take a look at this simple example. In a case like this, traffic forwarded to these servers will go to the router first. When a PC sends a message, what will the destination MAC address be? It won't be the server's MAC, it'll be the router's MAC. This is because the source and destination MACs are rewritten at each layer 3 hop. What this means is that when the switch sees the frames coming from the PCs, they will all have the destination MAC of the router. Now, what would happen if our hashing algorithm looked only at the destination MAC address? As it's the same value for every frame would get the same hash value. The result is that all traffic would be assigned to one physical link. We could say that the traffic is pinned to this link. So, if this was happening, we would change our load balancing method to include more information. Maybe source MAC or source IP address. What we really want is a lot of variety, which helps to spread the traffic across the physical links in the Etherchannel. The key point to take away from this is that there is no guarantee that traffic will be evenly spread across these links. We might be expecting 4 gig of bandwidth, but we might find that we're getting a bit less. We'll cover this a bit more in the lab if you're interested in taking a look. And here are the final 3 quiz questions. I think you'll enjoy thinking these ones through. To put all this in practice, we have this scenario. We want to use Etherchannels in our customer's network. Someone has even started configuring them for us. However, they don't know how to get them to work. You need to find out why they're not working and fix them. The next video is the last in the Layer 2 and switching section of this series. Head over to the next video to learn about power over Ethernet.